हेलो डियर चिल्ड्रन, आई वेलकम यू ऑल ऑन माय ऑनलाइन लर्निंग प्लेटफॉर्म लर्न इंग्लिश विद जांगिड सर। डियर चिल्ड्रन, टुडे आई हैव कम बिफोर यू विद अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट टॉपिक इन क्लास 12th इंग्लिश कोर द बुक फ्लेमिंगो। एंड टुडे वी विल डिस्कस the second chapter of our book Flamingo. The chapter is entitled Lost Spring, the stories of stolen childhood. So this is really a beautiful story, and the theme is also very important. But before we go through, I just want to introduce you with the author. This chapter is written by Anish Jung, who was born in 1964 in Rourkela and spent her childhood and adolescence in Hyderabad. She received her education in Hyderabad and in the United States of America. Her parents were both writers. She was brought up as a child in strict parda, but later went on to study at Osmania University and the University of Michigan, Ann Arbor, America, where she took a master's degree in sociology and American studies. She has been the editor of a magazine, Youth Times, and has written for several of the world's major newspapers. Anish Jung began her career as a writer in India. She has been an editor and columnist for major newspapers in India and abroad, and has authored several books also. The following is an excerpt from her book titled Lost Spring, Stories of Stolen Childhood. Here she analyzes the grinding poverty and the traditions which condemn these children to a life of exploitation. So in this book she discusses about poverty, child labor and the life of exploitation, particularly the exploitation of the small children. In this chapter, dear children, there are two stories actually, so we will discuss in two parts. The first part deals with child labor, and the second part also deals with child labor, but the places are different. Problem is the same, but the places are different, settings are different, circumstances are a little bit different. So we will discuss the theme of this topic. The story Lost Spring describes the pitiable, the poor condition of poor children who have been forced to miss the joy of childhood due to the socio-economic condition that prevails in this man-made world. Actually, dear children, childhood is the time for physical and mental development, moral development. But there are some unfortunate children in this world who do not get proper opportunities for their development, and this is really a serious problem, because childhood is known as the golden period of human life, and if in this raw age, if the children are forced to work, they are made the partners in survival, then this is really a big blot on the civilized society. But this happens in our country as well as in most of the countries of the world. The children are denied the opportunities of schooling and forced into labor early in life. Anish Jung gives voice to eliminate child labor by educating the children and to enforce the laws against child labor by the governments strictly. You know, child labor is a big curse. but still it is found in our country, in also many countries of the world. So certainly there are some laws against this evil, but still it is prevailing. So somewhere we have to take a strict action against the people who violate the law. The call is to end child exploitation and let the children enjoy the days of the spring that bring joy under their feet. So this should be the effort of society, of everybody, that every child on this planet, on this earth, should get proper opportunities for physical, mental and moral development. So the writer here actually raising her voice to eliminate this big evil of child labor. Now, as I told you, there are two parts. The first part is about the rag pickers of Simapuri in Delhi. Simapuri is a big slum in northeast Delhi, the capital city of our country. So this first part is entitled "Sometimes I Find a Rupee in the Garbage." The first part tells the writer's impressions about the life of the poor rag pickers. The rag pickers have migrated from Dhaka. Most of the rag pickers are the migrants from Bangladesh and found a settlement in Simapuri near Delhi. Their fields and homes had been swept away by storms. In Bangladesh, storms are a big problem. Every year they actually destroy their farms. They had come to the big city to find a living, some employment. They are poor. The writer watches Saheb every morning scrounging, means searching for gold in her neighborhood. Garbage is a means of survival. It is a means of earning for the elders and for the children. It is something wrapped in wonder. The children come across a coin or two from it. These people have desires and ambitions, but they do not know the way to achieve them. There are quite a few things that are unreachable to them, namely shoes, tennis and the like. Later, Saheb joins a tea stall where he could earn 800 rupees and all the meals. The job has taken away his freedom. So the first story clearly is about a boy, a rag picker named Saheb-e-Alam. He also lived in Simapuri. His whole family was engaged in the this profession of rag picking in the streets of Delhi. And these children are really very unfortunate children. So I just want to show you the glimpse of the kind of work they do, the kind of circumstances they live in. So for that I will show you a small documentary and then we will discuss this story according to the text.
Delhi, the capital city of India, is known to everyone as the state for all legislative and executive decisions. It is the center of trade, culture and literature in India. It is one of the fastest growing city of the country. Owing to its location, connectivity and rich cultural heritage, the city has always been one of the prime tourist attractions of the country. It also boasts of having the busiest metro rail network in the country. But Delhi is not only about the metropolis. It has got another side to it. Its underbelly, where some marginalized people struggle hard to earn their livelihood. But none of the tourists or even the regular Delhiites get to see them, because they are kept away from the so-called posh and affluent Delhi. They are resettled in the outskirts of the city. They strive night and day to maintain some semblance of humanity in their lives.
There's an old saying, one man's trash is another man's treasure, the origin of which has been lost to time. Rag pickers in India have been estimated between 1.5 to 4 crores. Delhi itself has over 5 lakhs of them. The Ratpikas of Simapuri live on the periphery of Delhi, yet, metamorphically speaking, away from it. These Ratpikas of Simapuri live as squatters. For them, garbage is gold and it is wrapped in wonder. For a child, it is his daily bread. He searches for glasses, old tin cans, pieces of woods, pots and pans. In literal sense, rat picking is a means of survival. Despite of their crucial service of keeping dynamic and surprisingly efficient urban waste management in place, India's rat pickers continue to struggle for survival in dire conditions, like exposure to harmful substances, poor wages, lack of civic amenities, and so on. Here's a glimpse of their work and world.
Till today, rat pickers like Sheikh Abdullah and Chand are not acknowledged under Indian laws, as consequences of which they undergo numerous forms of discrimination and are treated with contempt and suspicion by both society as well as the police. Moreover, they are excluded from various health and government schemes. Chaitanya strives to acknowledge ragpicking as a profession that would considerably aid to reduce the insecurity and stigma associated with it. The question that still prevails is, why do the ragpickers have to exist in an insecure setting even after doing work that benefits the municipality and society at large?
Children, after watching the video, you must have understood what kind of a place is Simapuri, what kind of a life the people live there. So really their condition is very pathetic. They do not enjoy any kind of civic facility, public facility, and they really live a life of deprivation and poverty. Now we will discuss the text. In the beginning of the story, the author is actually talking to Sahib and his friends in Simapuri. These small children are engaged in rag picking, in collecting the things with their parents. So the story begins with a dialogue with Sahib. "Why do you do this?" I asked Sahib, whom I encounter every morning, scrounging for gold in the garbage dumps of my neighborhood. Actually, the author was that time living in Delhi, and she was working on a write-up on the issue of child labor and rag picking in Simapuri. So she says that I often meet Sahib all of a sudden, and she finds Sahib searching gold in the garbage. So here gold in the garbage means they do not find gold, the metal, but gold here means something valuable, something important. So the children find some important things, coins or some money, then it is just like gold for them. Sahib left his home long ago, set amidst the green fields of Dhaka. His home is not even a distant memory. Actually, the people who are living in Simapuri, they are the Bangladeshi migrants, and they left their own country long back. There were many storms that swept away their fields and homes, his mother tells him. That is why they left, looking for gold in the big city where he now lives. So they came in search of employment in the big city, and they found this work to do for their livelihood. "I have nothing else to do." So the child answers very simply. The author asks him, "Why do you do this?" The child says, "I have nothing else to do." "Go to school," I say glibly, realizing immediately how hollow the advice must sound. So the writer said, "Go to school." But immediately she realized that this kind of advice was not good for these children. Because they are so poor, they don't have schools in the neighborhood, there are so many problems. There is no school in my neighborhood. When they built one, I will go. So the author says, if I start a school, will you come? I ask, half joking. Yes, he says, smiling broadly. So she says that if she starts a school, will he come? Then he said, yes, I will definitely come. A few days later, I see him running up to me. Now, see, the children are very innocent. That is why when you make a promise to the children, we must be very careful because they don't forget. So, a few days later, when again there was a meeting of these two, the child Sahib asks him, is your school ready? Then she answered, it takes longer to build a school. I say, embarrassed. See, this was a false promise actually. That is why the author felt embarrassed at having made a promise that was not meant. But promises like mine, now this is an irony, this is a satire on the situation, that promises like mine abound in every corner of his bleak world, in his dreary world. After months of knowing him, I ask him his name. One day she asked his name, then he said, Sahib-e-Alam, such a great name, he announces. He does not know what it means. If he knew it, its meaning, Lord of Universe. What is the meaning of Sahib-e-Alam? Lord of Universe. He would have a hard time believing it. Unaware of what his name represents, he roams the streets with his friends, an army of barefoot boys. The author calls the company of the children an army of barefoot boys, means they do not wear chappals or shoes, who appear like the morning birds and disappear at noon. Over the months, I have come to recognize each of them. So in Simhapuri, the author often comes there and she could easily recognize them. Why aren't you wearing chappals? I asked one. She says that she asked one child. My mother did not bring them down from the shelf, he answered simply. Even if she did, he will throw them off. It's another who is wearing shoes. They do not match, means they are not in proper pair. When I comment on it, he shuffles his feet and says nothing. I want shoes, says a third boy who has never owned a pair all his life. You see their condition. Even they do not have chappals or shoes to wear in their life. Traveling across the country, I have seen children walking barefoot in cities on village roads. It is not lack of money, but a tradition to stay barefoot is one explanation. Some people say that they can afford chappals or shoes, but they do not buy because it is a tradition to remain barefoot. But the author says, I wonder if this is only an excuse to explain away a perpetual state of poverty. Perpetual means regular, continuous. So she says that this is only an excuse to explain their condition of poverty. Now, here the author tells us a story. This story is actually taken in this chapter because the author wants to compare that how the things have changed with the passing of time. How people are benefited by prosperity, by development in the recent times. I remember a story a man from Udupi once told me. So, she says that once a man from Udupi in South India told me a story. She remembers it. What is the story? As a young boy, he would go to school past an old temple. So, the man who told the story to the author, he actually would go to school past an old temple. Means, he used to pass through an old temple where his father was a priest. And his father was actually a priest in that temple. He would stop briefly at the temple and pray for a pair of shoes. So, when he was a boy, this man, he would also stay at the temple and he prayed God to provide him a pair of shoes. Means that time he also did not have a pair of shoes. 30 years later, now you see, What changes are there? 30 years later, I visited his town and the temple, which was now drowned in an air of desolation. Means now there was not much movement and all. In the backyard where lived the new priest, there were red and white plastic chairs. You see how changes have come over there in their lives. Means they also use these things. Earlier, the priests in the temple or the people who just worked in the temples or in the religious places, they could not afford all these luxury items. A young boy dressed in a grey uniform wearing socks and shoes arrived panting and threw his school bag on a folding bed. Looking at the boy, I remembered the prayer another boy had made to the goddess when he had finally got a pair of shoes. Let me never lose them. See, so the boy that time prayed to goddess to provide him a pair of shoes, and when he found a pair of shoes, he again prayed that let him never lose them. The goddess had granted his prayer. Means now the children are the children of the priests. They are getting all the things. Young boys like the son of the priest now wore shoes, but many others like the rag pickers in my neighborhood remained shoesless. She says that even before 30 years, the condition of these rag pickers in Simhapuri was very pathetic, and even today also it is pathetic. Means there is no change in their life. Now, she says, my acquaintance, means my familiarity with them, my acquaintance with the barefoot rag pickers leads me to Simhapuri, a place on the periphery, on the boundary of Delhi, yet miles away from it metaphorically. Means this place is very close to Delhi, if you see physically, but if you see metaphorically, it is miles away from Delhi. Means Delhi is a very developed and a very good city. All the facilities are available there. But if you visit Simhapuri, you will not find anything. Those who live here are squatters. Squatters means the people who have come and settled there illegally. Encroachers who came from Bangladesh back in 1971. Syed's family is among them. Simhapuri was then a wilderness. That time nobody lived in Simhapuri in 1971. So they people came from Bangladesh and settled over there. It still is, but it is no longer empty. Although still there is no development, but now this place is full of people. In structures of mud, with roofs of tin and tarpaulin, devoid of sewage, drainage or running water. Means there is no facility in this Simhapuri locality. Live around 10,000 rag pickers. They have lived here for more than 30 years without an identity, without permits. Means they live there illegally. But with ration cards that get their names on voters list and enable them to buy grain. So due to politics or the leaders have just arranged their ration cards, so they get the ration from the public distribution system, and they can also enroll themselves as voters. So this is some kind of politics. We will not discuss about it. Food is more important for survival than an identity. So they people believe that food is more important for them. If at the end of the day we can feed our families and go to bed without an aching stomach, we would rather live here than in the fields that gave us no grain. Say a group of women in tattered saris, when I ask them why they left their beautiful land of green fields and rivers. Dhaka is a beautiful place. So she one day asked a group of women, and they answered that there every year their fields are destroyed by the storms. The fields do not yield any kind of grains, so they live there hungry. That is why they have come to this city. At least they are getting their food over there. Wherever they find food, they pitch their tents, and that become transit homes. Children grow up in them, becoming partners in survival. See, this is important. Here the children are the partners in survival. If you say in a civilized society, we children are not partners in survival, means our parents are earning, we are not earning. But in Simhapuri, the parents are also earning and the children also help them in earning, means they do not avail the facility of education. And survival in Simhapuri means rag picking. Through the years, it has acquired the proportion of a fine art. So they are so expert in it. Garbage to them is gold. To the people of Simhapuri, to the rag pickers, the garbage is not garbage. It is not dirty thing. It is gold for them because they get money with the help of it. It is their daily bread, a roof over their heads, even if it is a leaking roof. But for a child, it is even more. Now, it has a different meaning for children. For the parents, it is a means of survival. But what is more for a child? See, I sometimes find a rupee, even 10 rupee note. So Sahib says that sometimes we find some money also in the heap of garbage. His eyes lighting up. When you can find a silver coin in a heap of garbage, you don't stop scrounging. And when the children find something in the heap, we think that they will stop, but they don't stop searching, for there is hope for finding more. It seems that for children, garbage has a meaning different from what it means to their parents. For children, it has a different meaning. What is it? For the children, it is wrapped in wonder. Actually, for the children, it is a heap of wonderful things. And in the hope of finding the wonderful things, they just search something in it, try to search and search and search. For the elders, it is a means of survival. Now, one winter morning, I see Sahib standing by the fenced gate. Fenced means something which is protected by a fence, by the barbed wires, etc. Gate of the neighborhood club. Watching two young men dressed in white playing tennis. Actually, one day she met with Sahib, who was watching two rich people playing tennis in a club. "I like the game," he hums, content to watch it standing behind the fence. "I go inside when no one is around," he admits. "The gatekeeper lets me use the swing." So he just informs the author that he likes the game, that is why he watches the game, but he cannot play it, he knows. But he goes there inside during the daytime, because these rich people play there either in the morning or in the evening. So the gatekeeper, the guard there, allows the children to use the swings in the club. Sahib too is wearing tennis shoes that look strange over his discolored shirt and shorts. Actually, his shirt and shorts are dirty, and he is wearing tennis shoes, white tennis shoes. "Someone gave them to me," he says in the manner of an explanation. So when the author looked at the shoes, he explained in advance that someone gave them to me. The fact that they are discarded shoes of some rich boy who perhaps refused to wear them because of a hole in one of them does not bother him. Actually, he got the discarded shoes of a rich boy, but it is just like a dream come true for this child. For one who has walked barefoot, even shoes with a hole is a dream come true. But the game he is watching so intently is out of his reach. This is another satire, that these children are not capable of playing the game like tennis. Now see another scene. This morning, Sahib is on his way to the milk booth. One day actually, the author saw that Sahib was on his way to the milk booth. In his hand is a steel canister. "I now work in a tea stall down the road," he says, pointing in the distance. "I am paid 800 rupees and all my meals." Actually, he started working at a tea stall. Does he like the job? Now, you see, the author asked him a question. I ask him. His face, I see, has lost the carefree look. Means he did not like the new job. Although the new job was better than rake picking, but still he did not like it. Why? The steel canister seems heavier than the plastic bag he would carry so lightly over his shoulder. The bag was his. Now, this is the reason. The bag he used to collect garbage was his. Means he was the master of his own will. He had no master. The canister belongs to the man who owns the tea shop. Sahib is no longer his own master. Means now he is not the master. Now he is working under another master. So this way we can see that sometimes the children are engaged in other works of child labor, and this is also not good. We can see that the children do not get any kind of opportunity for education, and their condition is really very poor. Now we will see some comprehension questions. What is Saheb looking for in the garbage dumps? So he is actually looking for some coins, or we can say gold in the garbage. Where is he and where has he come from? So we know that he is in Simapuri in Delhi, and he has come from Dhaka. What explanations does the author offer for the children not wearing footwear? So one explanation is offered that it is a tradition to remain barefoot. This is offered. Is Saheb happy working at the tea stall? Obviously no. No, he is not happy. Why? Because in the rake picking, he was the master of his own will. He was totally free. But now, he was not free. He was working under a master. So that is why he was not happy. So this is the first thoughtful story, Lost Spring. So dear children, thank you very much. We will continue this chapter in the second part, where we will study the story of Mukesh, another good story. So just keep watching for the second part of this chapter. I thank you again very much for watching my lessons. Please like, share, comment and subscribe my YouTube channel, Learn English with Jangid Sir. This is all for today. Thank you and have a good day.